First of all, I want to thank everybody for coming here this afternoon. I know we all have a busy agenda running businesses, but I do appreciate the attendance. Again, we're here today to find out what the casino would do here for the business community outside of the jurisdiction to where they're going to erect the property. We all need to know what's advantageous so we're not losing business and what they're going to do for us. We're looking at a picture here of a $650 million investment in the city of Brockton. I don't know too many people that would make that kind of investment in Brockton, but I welcome it dearly. I'll probably be the last one to support a casino because I've never scratched a ticket in my life, nor have I ever been to one. But I am all about the $650 million investment here because I lived in Brockton all my life. So to elaborate on this, we're going to start off with, I'd like to introduce to you Chris Cooney, the president of the Metro South Chamber of Commerce, who has endorsed the casino, and he's going to tell you the reasons why. Chris?
So my job today is to warm you up a little bit, I think, for the mayor and everything else to come. But I did want to highlight the fact that the Chamber's board met this past week and took a vote. We took a vote in favor of a yes on May 12th for this project and this proposal to be moved forward for consideration. Brockton deserves to be considered. It deserves to be considered for a number of reasons, but first of all, fair is fair. Quite frankly, 5 years ago when the state, the referendum, decided to ban dog racing in our region, we were severely impacted in the middle of a recession. 600 jobs, 600 people put out of work. And right at that point, our board, the Chamber, Metro South Chamber of Commerce Board of Directors, voted that if the state should ever change their mind and bring back gaming to Massachusetts, that this region should be placed first on the list, that we should be given consideration, that we should be given some consideration towards restoring those jobs and putting those people back to work. And that enabled me, as the Chamber President, to testify on several occasions in favor of the Carney family at the Raynham site, where we were enthusiastic about the prospects of bringing gaming jobs back to this region and to that site. We did not succeed in that. But it did open up the opportunity for other proposals that were pretty much along the Route 24 corridor. Many of those didn't pan out. We did not realize, and we really did not anticipate, that there would be a site that would be singly controlled, already assembled, clean, and ready to go this close to Route 24 in the city of Brockton. But when we discovered that, and we discovered the fact that three sites had already been awarded the four licenses that are going to be from Evermore. We're talking about a major value in licenses. We could not do anything other than to support this proposal and support a yes for consideration. This city deserves to be considered. And this site, for several reasons, is a very, very good option for this final remaining license. Again, the three sites that have already been chosen, Plain Ridge, we had them here in this very room about a month and a half ago. They're opening in 30 days. They're way ahead of us. Springfield broke ground a couple of weeks ago, and Everett is going to be the next. It already has the license going. So this is the last remaining site. So with that said, we have a few slides I'd like to go over with you. I think Allison Van Dam from the Chamber is going to help me kind of guide through these slides. Let me get my version out here. So from a national perspective, this was never a moral issue for the Chamber of Commerce because we had said we weren't going to go out and lobby the state to bring back gaming. But if gaming were to come back, then we felt we should be given a chance. So it is the law of the land. Not only was it voted, a referendum failed, and so it is the law of the land, and it's not just here, it's nationwide. So if you look at the numbers there, $35.6 billion are being spent in the U.S. each year on entertainment in the form of gambling and gaming, mostly at resort casinos, increasingly at casinos that attract families and other activities to the site. And that is the model that we're looking at here. Of course, many, many people are employed, 339,000 people nationwide, $12.9 billion in wages, and they contribute a significant amount to the tax base. Again, we're talking about diversifying our entertainment options in the region and throughout the nation. So that's at a national level. If you look at New England currently, this region is among the most populated, this state and this region in New England. So Massachusetts has the most population. It has the most disposable income because we have high wage earners, especially in this region outside of Boston. And we're one of the most educated regions in the country. And yet, it doesn't make sense to me as one of those people who were born and raised here, who falls into some of those categories at least, I can't figure out from a smarts perspective why $1.1 billion is being spent in Rhode Island and Connecticut by Massachusetts residents, and we don't have an option here. Why do we have to drive that far to spend that kind of money for entertainment? What we're looking at here is Massachusetts residents in a recent study represent in the parking lot and in the casinos the largest portion of vehicles and patrons, both in Rhode Island and Connecticut, in many instances. If we go back to the regional casino a little bit and our perspective on this, it did start with the elimination of dog racing and those jobs, because for the Chamber of Commerce, we want to see economic prosperity, but we also want to see people back to work, especially in industries that they're trained in. That vote, as you recall, was mostly voted by people in Western Massachusetts. Eastern Massachusetts voted to retain dog racing, and that is an important distinction. Today, we have a site in Brockton that is put together by the Carney family. The development team is experienced. We have Neil Bloom. Let me tell you a little about Neil. I had a chance to talk with the chamber executive in Schenectady. Schenectady, New York was just selected about a year ago as the site for a casino along the river there. There are a lot of parallels between Brockton and Schenectady, but the confidence that the chamber exec had gained throughout the process in this particular developer, Neil Bloom, is really unparalleled. In fact, he was grilled extensively about his partners, his finance plan, and how he was going to go about getting this done in the middle of a recession. Of course, they started a little bit their process of approval a little bit before we did, and the economy was a little worse, and the market wasn't back, and that type of thing. And they in a public hearing, went after Mr. Bloom and asked him about his experience. And he was able to point to the casinos he'd already developed. He invited them to go out to the casinos and see the quality and the consistency in development. The fact that he paid attention to the local community. The fact that he worked in custom units and custom considerations in each community to make that casino as successful as it could possibly be while making the residents and the community happy. But when it comes down to financing, we know that, we've read in the paper and we've seen a lot of entities hiccup and pause a bit, because you never know in the middle of a recession if somebody's actually come through with the financing. You don't really want to, as New York State folks said, approve a casino operator who then can't make it happen. So they went after him, and he paused for a moment, and he said, listen, I will underwrite this myself. I will write the check myself. And for anybody who doubts that he can't do that, Forbes' list of the wealthiest people in the world rank him as a net value of $3 billion. It's hard to find a partner like that. It's hard to find someone to come and be able to spend $650 million in a community and have the assurance that they actually can. So that is, I think, speaks to his ability to be a very positive partner in this. George Carney is a lifelong resident of Brockton. He's been a very good steward of those properties and the fairgrounds for many, many years. He's kept the buildings in place and up in the anticipation of restoring them. I was delighted to see the design of these buildings really mirror and match that old statehouse building that's there, the classic New England design, that will move that property and that particular building from being a beacon of despair to a fun, enlightening option for entertainment and inviting entrance to the city of Brockton. So I'm happy to see that. Let's talk a little bit about the Brockton Casino proposal itself. We're looking at 25 acres, $650 million, $10 million a year in annual payments, $3 million upfront payment when the casino opens. You're looking at 1,500 jobs, 1,400 construction jobs, people working on that site immediately. Let's keep in mind that this site is really distinguishes itself. It's within 18 miles of Boston. It's 25 contiguous acres. It's under single ownership and control, and it doesn't have much on it to begin with. That's hard to find, and so the fact that they can get up and running and create those construction jobs right away is of value. Once they are up and running and hiring folks, you're looking at $50,000 average compensation. That includes benefits and whatnot, but they're decent jobs. We're looking at, you see there the sectors and the different percentages. Food and beverage, 34%. Facilities, you've got operations at 34%. You've got a good varied amount of jobs and in different industry sectors within the casino operations, and I think that is a great opportunity for many, not just for startup jobs, but also part-time jobs and summer jobs and many, many jobs that will be available there. Additional economic development benefits, you know, they number, and you're gonna hear a few from the mayor and from others, but ultimately what you're looking at is some real positives to this site. It puts, I think it was said by the mayor and by also the new 21st Century Corporation director, it gives a reason for people to not pass through Brockton, but actually go to Brockton. And that will result in people discovering Brockton. People that otherwise may not have come to Brockton will come and see an experience and know what we found out, that when you're in Brockton, when you're in Brockton, we're in the metropolitan area. So. And you're at a convenient location. With that said, there'll be hotel, 250 rooms. Meals tax also will be generated. Hotel and rooms tax will be generated for the city, and that is a very positive thing, especially where we're, as a community, facing very high tax rates overall. Some of the things I talked with the Schenectady Chamber exec about were the opportunities for small businesses within the community. And Rush Street has made a commitment here, as they have in Schenectady, to create a priority list for vendors. So that's existing Brockton businesses that want to do business with a casino will be encouraged to come to a vendor fair, be vetted and approved, and be able to do business right here in the community. They've also have committed to a gift card program of $50,000 per year for small businesses. Those rewards will go out to employees that excel, but also to players that are frequent gamers at the facility, or people that stay and come to the actual the various entertainment that is offered there as well. So, I guess in summary. You know, after 69 years of legal gaming in the form of dog racing, having it eliminated 5 years ago, it hit us. It hit us with 600 jobs lost. We feel as though Brockton and this site deserves to be considered. And that's why we think a yes vote is absolutely essential. What I'll close with is this vote is going to be closer than we think. There are many people who have heard rumor, have heard stories about things they think may or may not happen. There are personal stories that we all are aware of people that are possibly addicted to gaming or Vegas type stories. This is a suburban casino. If you've ever been to Europe, many of these casinos are in old neighborhoods near the historic church and up the street from the marina. And they operate in exactly the way this one would, which is to provide an entertainment option for people who may want to go out to dinner one night and have a glass of wine or a bottle of wine. The next night, maybe they'll play cards, and maybe the next night they'll see a show. And to have them do that here in Brockton, we think should at least be considered by voting yes on the 12th. We're going to need votes. And many of you are employers. Many of you are familiar with the community here in the city of Brockton. You are friends, you have neighbors, you grew up here. I think we need to kind of take an extra effort to sit down with folks and ask them why they're opposed to this and how they're going to vote, and encourage them to take a little closer look at what it means to be considered. Because quite frankly, folks, even if we get a yes vote, we may not be selected, but at least we should be considered. And I think it's going to take an awful lot of employees at our local businesses to be encouraged to go out and vote on May 12th. And that may mean encouraging folks to understand the facts in this case, the value to them, the options that they will have. It's funny, I had a small business owner ask me, will my employees be taken away? Will they be offered more money? Will they be enticed into a better job at this casino? And how will that impact me? And the data tells us that there are 42,000 working adults in the city of Brockton. 60% of those from the census leave this city every day to work. The majority of those folks travel to Boston, and they work in entry-level to mid-level jobs. And they do that because they can get paid 30% more and live very cost-effectively in this city. We have the lowest value for homes and for commercial property within 20 miles of Boston. And so they can jump on public transportation and make an extra $4 or $5 an hour, and they bring it home and they spend it here in Brockton. Well, I can tell you, the same is true for Brockton businesses that recruit. They recruit oftentimes from Fall River and New Bedford, because where a job that pays $10 in New Bedford and Fall River pays $13 here in Brockton. And it's within 35 miles. And the US Census tells us that people will travel 35 miles for an extra $3 an hour. And guess what? Fall River, New Bedford people drive to Brockton and they work. So I think there will be plenty of people for the jobs here in Brockton. We have a great location. And we can draw from both Fall River, New Bedford, Taunton, as well as bring people home, bring Brocktonians home, so that they can improve their quality of life here in the city of Brockton, working right here down the street, be home for the kids when they get home, and participate in the sports leagues, by adding more jobs to the city. So we encourage you not only to vote yes, but encourage your employees, your friends, your neighbors. We think Brockton's worth it. We think we should be at the table and we should be considered. And that's the only way we are going to. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris, very much. You got to all the high points when it comes down to business. We have a video to show. It's going to last about 6 minutes. Then I'll do some more introductions for the speakers. We ready to roll on the video?
Brockton is a city that refuses to die. It's tough. It's like Tombstone, Arizona. It will not go away. The good people of Brockton are going to survive and they're going to win. If there were a casino in Brockton, it would put us on the map.
Having a casino in the city of Brockton is going to help the whole city. It's going to help the residential taxpayers, commercial taxpayers. It's going to help the school system with an infusion of new revenue coming in.
By bringing all that money, that $10 million, that's going to help us with the firefighter, with the police, and definitely with the school.
Brockton PD could hire more officers. They could have better equipment. They could buttress their gang unit and drug unit.
What other project would bring in as much as $10 million in revenue to the city on an annual basis? What other industry would provide that type of employment for people in the city?
The 1,500 jobs that the casino is going to bring to the city, that's a huge plus for the city.
I can't see another corporation or company or entity coming into the city of Brockton with these kind of jobs for us, at these kinds of salaries, with these kinds of benefits.
If you have 1,500 people who are working, They have to go to the grocery store, the gas station. They can't do anything but help the city. I mean, they live here, they're gonna spend their money here.
We are the city of champions. There is no disputing that. You know, Rocky Marciano, Bob's mom and Hagler. And to this day, we still have the continuing pride in our city. There's no sports in our middle schools anymore because there's no way to pay for it.
So if we don't have any athletics in the junior high, it hurts the whole program. You have to have middle school sports. If you're cutting middle school sports without money, that's just the start. What next, the music program?
What if this revenue that's coming to the casino was going to the city schools to restore our program so that you're not always looking for the general public to pay for these sports programs throughout the school, not just the high school, but gearing the kids all the way up from the elementary level on. Let's restore the city of champions.
We're very, very fortunate to have Rush Street Gaming and Neil Bloom. For decades, he has been developing real estate projects, including Faneuil Hall and Copley Place and shopping centers around the country. His companies have a wonderful culture of hiring people from the local communities first.
One of the advantages we really had is that first and foremost, we've been real estate developers, developing great real estate projects. So we know how to build a really first-class project, do it on time and on budget, get it financed, and most importantly, make sure that it integrates into the community where we're building. We've had terrific relationships with the communities that we operate in.
Displains is a story of recovery and revitalization. Over the last 5 years, we've really been able to take a city that was nearly broke. We've been able to pay down significant debt, invest in our infrastructure, and give back to the residents, which was the promise of the casino from the beginning.
It really means a lot that what we do in the community really makes a difference.
Rivers Casino has supported us in a variety of different ways.
In addition to financial investments, Rivers really makes a point to have their employees be involved in community work.
What Rivers Casino does for us gives back to the Chicago community as a whole by getting folks back into the workforce. If people aren't working, they can't support their families.
Rivers has been a tremendous asset to our region, culturally, socially, and economically.
It's not like your typical job. It's more like coming to work and having fun.
It's never a dull moment, ever.
It doesn't feel like work.
I'm very proud to work at Rivers.
It's a great job.
Rivers is truly the crown jewel that really improved the look and feel of an entire corridor of our city.
So we not only have a great opportunity for hotel, resort, casino to be developed, but we can have the assurance that a developer with the reputation of Neil Bloom is going to make things that more positive.
With that money, we will restore our pride, we will restore our confidence, and our kids as well will have the opportunity to, you know, to keep their heads up and say, you know what, I'm from Brockton, the city of champions, the city of the great leaders.
I think definitely with a casino in Brockton, Brockton would be a real city of a champion. If that happened, then it would be so wonderful. I think it's a dream come true to see that happen in the city of Brockton.
We'll be very excited. Will bring more lights to Brockton.
Get out there, talk to your friend, and explain to them the meaning of having a casino in Brockton, and I think they will go for it. And I will suggest them, go out, talk to their friend, and go vote yes.
Yes for Brockton.
Yes for Brockton schools.
Business.
Jobs.
Police. Sports.
Haitian community.
Community Capriens.
African American community.
Yes for Brockton's future.
Yes for Brockton on May 12th.
Yes for Brockton. Well, you heard from a lot of good old Brocktonians, people who have lived here all their life. I myself grew up right next to the fairgrounds on Belcher Avenue. I just rekindled an old friendship with George Carney, who was very friendly with my dad, and we reminisced a little bit about what the fairgrounds used to be in the 1950s and 60s. Well, of course, that changes over the period of time. The time has come. The time has come that George would like to do something with that property that would be advantageous to our city. This is what he wants. He wants something that is beneficial to everybody, not just a chosen few. George is a great man, and I do appreciate you doing this for us, George. Thank you. Now I'd like to introduce another great man, a good friend, a colleague, and now I call him my mayor, Mayor Bill Carpenter.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. First of all, thank you for coming out on a kind of cold, rainy, late afternoon, early evening, and it's great to see so much interest in this proposal. When we came into office 15 months ago, we set three clear goals: to restore safe and clean neighborhoods to the city, to make city government more user-friendly and accessible by implementing 21st century technology, and to revitalize the city's economy, built around creating jobs and providing real property tax relief. And I know we have a lot of, this audience includes a lot of business people. And so they will tell you, they know what the commercial tax rate is here in the city of Brockton, $33.88 per thousand, one of the highest in the state, one of the highest in the region. And as we are having a lot of success in many areas, revitalizing our economy and working to attract business and attract investment to this city, probably one of the biggest obstacles we face is that commercial tax rate, because a company is thinking about coming here, thinking about expanding here, but they look at some of the surrounding communities where they can benefit from many of the benefits of Brockton, but pay a lower commercial tax rate by locating themselves in a nearby community. So we know that we have to develop alternative sources of revenue, and we have to broaden the property tax base. We need to be a thriving city where more and more businesses can all pay a little bit less each, but generate more revenue to run the city on. And so that certainly has been one of our focus as we go into our second year now. And we've had a lot of successes. You know, we're bringing a college campus to downtown Brockton. We've put together a great economic development team. And we are day by day changing people's perception and view in terms of Brockton being a good place to do business and a good place to invest your money. About 3 or 4 months ago, the casino proposal was brought to me for the first time, the idea of the fairgrounds serving as a venue for a resort casino, not a slots parlor, a resort casino. And I was immediately intrigued by the opportunity, but like many, I certainly have had some questions. And we've done a lot of work over the last few months to get to a point where I can wholeheartedly support this proposal and believe in my heart that this is good for the city. I view this, really what we're trying to develop with Brockton is to create a city of opportunity, a 21st century city of opportunity, opportunities for people to start their own business, opportunities for people to own their own home, opportunities for people to get a first-class public school education for their children so their children can create their own opportunities. And that's my vision of Brockton. And now this proposal comes along, and I see this development as an opportunity for the city of Brockton, an opportunity that will bring a number of benefits. And Chris kind of ran through them, but I want you to know that on behalf of the city, we retained a top-notch law firm, Mintz Levin, out of Boston, who was instrumental in negotiating the Wynn Everett deal to represent the city in negotiating the host community agreement. We believe that this host community agreement will bring some great benefits to the residents of the city. And it starts with jobs. We need jobs in the city of Brockton. We've got a great workforce. We've got a workforce that's willing to do an honest day's work for an honest day's pay. But we also have an unemployment rate of over 7%. And we need jobs for growth in the city. And not just minimum wage jobs, but jobs that provide a weekly paycheck that someone can actually support their family on, jobs that actually provide benefits. And this resort casino will generate those types of jobs. And one of the things we negotiated in that host community agreement was a residency preference in hiring. It's in the agreement. So every time the casino goes to fill a position to hire a new employee, Brockton residents that are qualified for that position go to the front of the line and they get the first crack at the jobs. And I think that was something that was very important to us, to get that in the agreement so that we know, maybe not all of the jobs, but we know that the vast majority of the jobs are going to go to Brockton families. And these are jobs that, in my view, for many families here in the city who are struggling and living paycheck to paycheck, it's an opportunity to improve their quality of life and improve the future for their family. And I believe those jobs and those opportunities will be transformative for the city of Brockton. I think another aspect of our agreement that's not talked about enough is the local purchasing requirement. Again, I realize I'm speaking to a mostly business audience here today. In the host community agreement, there is a requirement. The casino, besides being a major employer and being a major draw to bring people into the city, is also going to be a major customer for a lot of folks. A 225-room hotel, 5 or 6 restaurants, the casino, all of the other services that they provide, they will be purchasing a lot of goods and services. And in our agreement, whenever they're purchasing goods and services, they must look in the city of Brockton first. And if they can purchase that good or service at a competitive price here in the city of Brockton, they have to do business in Brockton first. And then if that's not immediately available in the city, there's a secondary preference for the communities that surround Brockton, because we want to include our neighbors too in the prosperity that will be generated by this casino. Think about the effect of that. You know, this is going to be a major complex that will be purchasing millions of dollars in goods and services. Most of that money will be poured back into the local economy. So it's not just about creating jobs in the casino. It's about creating jobs at other Brockton-based businesses that will benefit by having the casino as a customer. And then, of course, the $10 million per year to the city, total, $8 million in lieu of taxes, $1.5 million for community impacts, $500,000 a year for charity, total of $10 million per year. That truly is a game changer for the financial future of the city. Middle school sports are mentioned in the video. Our challenges with the school budget are much larger than just middle school sports. I think middle school sports have become a symbol for the financial challenges we're facing in the school budget. But under the current system, a gateway city like Brockton is just not being funded properly by the state and the feds. And locally, we just can't make up all of the difference. And our school budget is under strain. We had to make painful cuts last year in the school budget. And we're certainly approaching the next budget with a lot of concern as to how we continue to provide that first-rate quality public school education that's so important to the children of Brockton, that provides all of our children with a level playing field as they grow up and seek their own opportunities. And so this money coming into the city budget, $9.5 million a year directly into the city budget, that's going to allow us to properly support our schools. That money will go towards paying teachers, public safety, police officers, firefighters, providing the basic services we need in the city and supporting our schools at the same time. And we're committed to putting all of that money back directly into those services for the residents of the city. And so instead of, particularly in our business community, going back to fewer and fewer and asking them to pay more and more, this generates millions of dollars of additional revenue that we don't have to go to the taxpayers and take it out of their pocket in this endless cycle of continuous tax increases. And the final point I'd just like to make, I know there's other people that want to speak, but another reason, or maybe the main reason I'm so supportive of this proposal is when we think about economic revitalization of the city, when we think about the challenges that face Brockton as we remake Brockton into a livable city in the 21st century, I think perhaps our biggest challenge, our biggest obstacle is changing the perception of the city. How do people view the city of Brockton? Particularly, how do people outside the city of Brockton view us and view our city? And in the business sector, we're working very hard to change our perception that we are a city that wants to work with business and develop business and create jobs. But even more so, the overall perception of the city, how would that be positively impacted by seeing this large, beautiful entertainment complex drawing thousands of people every day into the city of Brockton, where I believe, you know, they come in and pull into that beautiful complex and they look around and they say, wow, this is Brockton? Because it doesn't fit with that preconceived notion that they have of the city. And as Chris mentioned, I think it's a destination. People make plans to come to Brockton, to come here. So instead of being a place where people are trying to just drive right through, Brockton now becomes a destination where people are coming to the city. And I do think the developers have shown a commitment to work with us to make sure that other local businesses also benefit from the commerce that's created by folks coming to the city through the rewards program, through local purchasing. And I think this is just really critical how this could be transformative in terms of how it changes people's perception of the city of Brockton from outside the city. And I think that, you know, we can't just place too much emphasis on the benefit that that could bring. So, you know, I have asked a lot of questions. I didn't embrace this proposal the first time it was brought to me, but I saw the opportunity. And as I had a chance for us to do our due diligence on Rush Street Gaming and find out more about this developer that was looking to come in here and invest over $500 million in the city in what would become the largest single private investment ever in the history of the city, I was pleased with what we found. And as I've had a chance, and I know Neil Bloom is on his way in shortly, as I've had a chance to get to Neil, to get to know Neil a little bit better and some of the people who work for him, I do have a comfort level with them. And as Chris spoke to people in Schenectady, New York, I've spoken to people in Pittsburgh who were very positive in terms of the benefits that the Rivers Casino in Pittsburgh has brought to the Pittsburgh area, and reinforcing the fact that they feel that Rush Street Gaming did keep the promises that were made when they proposed that casino in Pittsburgh. And we'll continue to do our due diligence. We'll continue to work closely. But I know that folks, particularly folks that live near the fairgrounds, are concerned about impacts. And I'm concerned about impacts too. And we've had some real straightforward conversations from day one. And that's why in the state gaming law and in the host community agreement, there's very specific language that requires an independent traffic consultant to do a study, establish what the impacts would be on traffic, and for the developer to pay the cost of whatever remedies are prescribed by that study. And there will be a separate independent study in the same token around public safety. And again, it's in the gaming law, it's in the host community agreement that we'll evaluate and see what the potential impacts are on public safety. And whatever those impacts are, the casino developers will have to pay for the mitigation for us to offset those impacts. So I don't think anyone's been more concerned about traffic safety and pedestrian safety and bicyclist safety than I have been in the past year. We've already spent a lot of time looking at that stretch of Belmont Street. Old Colony Planning Council has already been working with us on studies on both Forest Avenue and Belmont Street. And I think that done properly, this will actually create an opportunity. We're trying to develop plans that will take years and years to get the state to fund for infrastructure improvements for traffic in those areas. Under this agreement, if Brockton is fortunate enough to have the casino built here, we're going to get a lot of those traffic infrastructure improvements much faster and paid for with the developer's private money instead of getting in line with everyone else and waiting for years fighting to try to get some of those projects funded by the state. So I think that today will be the first, I hope, of many public forums. I know that three of our city councilors are hosting an open public forum tomorrow evening at West Middle School with the people from Rush Street Gaming, and I hope that everyone here will encourage others to come out for that meeting tomorrow night. And I've encouraged the developers that they need to continue to expand this dialogue with the residents of the city, because this gaming law was established with the referendum ballot question as a requirement. As a city, we get to make the decision if this is good for Brockton. And the residents ultimately will decide. I believe over the next 31 or 32 days, a lot of information will be provided. And I do believe that the vast majority of our residents, when they see the benefits that this development can bring to our city, will support the casino and will vote yes on the ballot question on May 12th. So I thank you for your time and I thank you for your attendance. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well, you heard it. Tourism on the table, disposable income on the table. People who would not normally come to the city of Brockton are now gonna be able to come here, and they get, if they use the train station and they use the T, they're getting off in the middle of the city and with gift cards to spend downtown for $100, they might decide to stay downtown before they go to the casino, or go to the casino and then end up downtown. But again, it's people that would not normally come to Brockton with a disposable income. Moving right along, at this time I'd like to introduce to you a lifelong Brocktonian and a good friend of mine. He's president of the NAACP, Stephen Bernard. Stephen?
I believe that we can win. 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 So I'm up here to be your cheerleader for today. We all have a stake on May 12th. I believe that we can win. I believe that we, Okay. Our biggest fear is not that we are inadequate. Our biggest fear is that we are powerful beyond measure. We should not give in to mediocrity. We need to realize opportunity and seek opportunity and look for growth. You as business people need to share that philosophy with your customers, your families, and friends. We have a project that's coming to Brockton that's going to bring economic stability to some families that have otherwise not been able to realize economic stability because they don't have jobs. 1,500 jobs going to local residents of Brockton and surrounding towns first. That's significant. That is very, very significant. I believe that we can win. I believe that you have a stake, that I have a stake, that everybody in the community has a stake in making certain that Brockton has the opportunity for the Gaming Commission of Massachusetts to choose this as the next site for a full casino. Our job is to get to that point. You, as business people, are going to benefit. Your hard work, I really appreciate all these people, that all of you who have worked so hard, given up, sacrificed so much to make your businesses successful. And I'm a proud Brocktonian, a lifelong Brocktonian. Chose to live and stay here in Brockton. and to represent on a civil rights level through the NAACP, not only my community, but your community, our community. I believe we can win. I believe that upon our victory on May 12th, that the Gaming Commission of Massachusetts will realize that we're a community that wants, needs, and embraces this opportunity. I believe that we can win because we have the right people, the right project, and that this is the right time and the right place for the next casino to be built. If I were to ask each one of you, and I know, the man in you, let me see the boy in you, all the men, and for the women, let me see the girl in you. If I ask you to say after me, I believe, and then I ask you to say that we, and then all together we say, I believe that we can win, would you join me? Let's try it. I believe that we. I believe that we can win.
I believe that we can win.
On May 12th, vote yes for Brockton. Vote yes for jobs. Vote yes for the casino project. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Reverend Bernard. You're a tough act to follow, believe me, my friend. Yes, I believe we can win, but it's going to take all of us in a joint effort aiming for the same goal, to prosper here in the city of Brockton. I want to thank you all for making an investment here in the city of Brockton and staying with us, but I want you to prosper and go on to the future and make a good living, not just for yourselves, but for your families. And going on with this, I'm going to introduce you to an old Brocktonian, an old friend, a man that's looking out for each and every one of us, and he wants to do the right thing, Mr. George Carney.
These are tough acts to follow, so George, get used to it. Anyway, I want to thank everybody for taking the time and coming here today and spending it with us, and all the nice things have been said about this project. Now we got to live up to them. First of all is this, that I've lived in Brockton most of my life. I still live in Brockton. I am a firm believer that Brockton has got a great opportunity, and I'm hoping that this opportunity will make it even better. I have been involved with the Brockton Fair for better than 50 years. I took it over when I was 28 years old. And anyway, everything in my life has been uphill ever since. It's like everything else, you have good days and bad days, but you have to live with them. But this is a great opportunity for the city. I've had many opportunities to develop the fair in the past. Some of them, when I went home and told my wife that I wasn't interested in doing it, I can't say that she was too happy about that, because she's been trying to get me to slow down for a number of years. And every time she talks about it, I tell her I got a 10-year game plan. And that's been continuing for the last 40 years or better. But anyway, this is a great opportunity to have a man come along that has that kind of money in his pocket. And I had the opportunity to be introduced to him and took advantage of it. I think this is something that would be great for the city. I'm very proud to stand behind it. I know that the fair is going to have to be developed in the near future, but there's nothing I can do to bring to Brockton that's going to produce that kind of income. That's a great, is a great opportunity for $650 million. You don't get people to come along like that every day. I have passed on some things that the Walmart was very interested, but I had pros and cons with it. And anyway, I passed on that and several other opportunities, but this is what I think is too good to pass on. I can never develop anything at the fair that's going to bring that kind of money guaranteed into the city. I can't guarantee 1,500 jobs, and all of those things are all pluses. This is an opportunity that's only comes along once in a lifetime. When I had an application for Rainham, I felt kind of bad about it when we weren't selected, But when I went home, I told my wife, I said, when one door closes, another one opens. I never thought it would be this soon, and I'm very happy that there's a great opportunity for me to be here today to ask you for your vote on the city of Brockton on May 16th. As far as the thing is concerned, I think it would be great for the city, and if it wasn't, I wouldn't be behind it. The mayor has been very supportive. The council has been very supportive. We got a vote through the city council at Lebanon to nothing, and I see a couple of the councilors here tonight. I want to thank them from up here, but anyway, as far as the thing is concerned, I want to thank everybody for coming, and I think it would be great for the city, and it's something that I'll be very proud to leave behind. Thank you.
I can guarantee you that's from his heart. That's how George talks, from his heart. He's a lifelong Brocktonian and loves his city and loves everybody in it. At this time, I'd like to take the opportunity to meet the people that are actually going to be in charge of this whole concept, the people from Rush Street. At this time, I'd like to introduce David Patton.
Good evening, everybody, and I apologize for our late arrival. We were literally fogged in Chicago for about 4.5 hours before we finally were able to leave. So we landed in Providence, drove up here as fast as we could, and here we are. Thank you very much for everybody's attendance tonight. What I'd like to do is take you through a few different things. First, introduce you to the principals of the project. You all know George Carney. We've been very happy to work with George. I'm going to give you a little background on Neil Bloom and our company, and then take you through some of the high-level highlights of the project itself. And then I don't know what our program calls for afterwards. Are we doing a Q&A afterwards? Great, and we'll be available for questions. And I'll tell you a little bit of background about the principals at Rush Street as well. So Mass Gaming and Entertainment, that's the group that's bringing the Brockton Resort Casino proposal to you. George Carney is, I'm sure all of you know, and we have gotten to know over the past couple of months. And then Rush Street Gaming, that's us. We're a Chicago-based company. We operate three casinos in Chicagoland area, in Des Plaines, in Philadelphia, and in Pittsburgh. And all these casinos have been open in the last five and a half years or more recently. We employ over 4,000 team members. We do over $1 billion in gaming revenue. And we were recently selected just last December to build and operate the only casino resort in the capital region of New York. That's something we're in the design phases now, and we hope to have open sometime either late 2016 or early 2017. Now, Neil Bloom is the chairman of Rush Street and the principal. He has been a very successful real estate developer over the last 43 years, has done over $50 billion in real estate development and acquisitions. Neil's a big philanthropist in the Chicago area and very involved in a number of civic causes. Just a few of the projects that Neil has been involved in. He was significantly involved in the development of Copley Place in Boston, the Chicago Mercantile and Exchange Center in Chicago, the MGM Tower in Los Angeles, Faneuil Hall in Boston, the 900 North Michigan Avenue building, which hosts the Four Seasons Hotel, retail, and also our offices are located at 900 North Michigan. Also helped develop the Four Seasons Hotel in Philadelphia. So, This shows you where our current projects are. Now, Neil got involved in the casino business, started in the mid-1990s, actually, when they responded to a request for proposal up in the province of Ontario. You can see where it says Falls View Casino Resort. That project was built in the early 2000s. The province of Ontario had developed a casino in Windsor, and they'd actually done it themselves, and they'd gone way over budget. It was late. It was really a disaster. So they decided the next time they wanted a private developer to do it, and Neil partnered up with the folks from Hyatt. They built that project on time, on budget. It's been one of the most successful, if not the most successful, casino in Canada. After having success with that project, they decided to pursue some licenses domestically, and were able to get a license in Philadelphia to build what is now the Sugar House Casino. Also took over a project in Pittsburgh for a developer who basically ran out of money, was unable to complete the project, and brought that project in Pittsburgh, the Rivers Casino there, on time and on budget. And then built Rivers Casino in Des Plaines, which is just outside Chicago, right near O'Hare Airport, also on time and on budget. So a pretty good track record so far with our developments. This just gives you a high level look at the gaming revenue for each project, how big each casino is. You know, there's been over, I believe, about $3 billion of capital put into all of our projects. And as I mentioned, the projects in the U.S. have all been open since 2009, so pretty new and recent developments. Just some pictures of just to give you an idea of the kinds of facilities that we build. Rivers Casino in Des Plaines is our most recent opening, which is in July 2011. The Sugar House in Philadelphia, which is currently undergoing a $165 million expansion. Given the timing of that project, which really got financed during the Great Recession, we were actually the only casino company that got greenfield, brand new projects financed during the Great Recession. They had to build a much smaller facility than what was originally envisioned. And so now we're finally able to take that project to what it was intended to be. We're adding a little bit of gaming, but a lot of food and beverage, meeting spaces, entertainment spaces to make that truly a full destination casino. And the Rivers Casino in Pittsburgh, which is currently our biggest casino, was a almost $800 million development, a very beautiful facility there. And then you see a rendering of our project in Schenectady, which, as I mentioned, is in its design phase. And then the project that was developed in Canada, up near Niagara Falls, the Falls View Casino, also very successful, beautiful setting, nice hotel, really a spectacular development. I've been up there a couple times. It's quite a great place to be. So this slide just gives you a high level look at some of the awards that our casinos have won. It's a very small snapshot. I think our casino in Pittsburgh's been awarded over 100 best of awards. Fallsview's been Ontario's favorite casino for 6 consecutive years. Rivers in Pittsburgh has been the best overall gaming resort in the state of Pennsylvania for 5 years in a row. And then Rivers Casino in Des Plaines, best casino for 3 years running. Rivers in Des Plaines is actually, I think, has the highest win per position of any casino in the country. And we outperform the nearest rival in Illinois by over 2-1 in terms of revenue. It's been extremely successful. We're very proud of the management teams at each property. All of our places, we place a huge emphasis on making sure that we provide a great work environment for our team members. And we're very pleased that each of our casinos has been awarded a top workplace award. In Pittsburgh 2014, Philadelphia has won it every year that they've been in operation, and in Des Plaines the same. they've won it for 3 consecutive years, and we're hoping that this year brings our 4th consecutive year. We have very diverse workforces. Really reflect the communities in which we operate. You can see female minority, close to 50% in each location. Pittsburgh's a little lower because the Pittsburgh tends to be just less diverse in terms of what its population is. And then at the vice president up, so these are the senior executives, almost half female and close to 40% minority representation. Oops. So one of the other things that we really emphasize is we want our team members to really integrate themselves into the communities and spend time, whether it's doing charitable work or civic functions. We opened a farmer's market. That picture in the center is from our farmer's market in Des Plaines. It's the only farmer's market apparently that the town of Des Plaines has ever had. We are very happy to be involved in that. Really, really take seriously commitment to the communities and our team members, we think, get a lot out of being involved in whether it's painting houses or helping to build houses, working at homeless shelters, soup kitchens, etc. It's something that they take pride in and really enjoy. So when we opened Sugar House in 2010, which is our casino in Philadelphia, more than 35% of the people that came to work for us were unemployed before they came to work for us. One of the things that we really work hard at is finding the local groups that represent and are advocates for and give assistance to people who are either underemployed or unemployed, partnering with them, figuring out how to reach their constituents, help them understand what is necessary, the kinds of skills, the kind of background that is required or that can be helpful for a casino job, and then really doing significant outreach to make sure that we give them opportunities to become fully employed with us, because there are a lot of jobs, obviously, that are going to be available, but but a lot of them require skills that people may not have, and so we want to make sure that they understand what those are, that we understand who the candidates are, so that we can give full opportunity for them, and we think we've been pretty successful so far with that. So one of the things that people will say that they're concerned about, and I think it's a legitimate concern, is when a new business like a casino comes to town, what does it do to local business, and what happens to the local neighborhood? And what we found in each of the places that we operate is that it actually helps to add to the local community. Local businesses actually prosper, and there is increased development when our casinos come to town. In Pittsburgh, this is a shot of Pittsburgh, there's a commuter rail that they built largely in part because they knew that the casino was going to be there. We are actually the final stop. And there have been a number of new businesses that have popped up. There's an entertainment center that's been built since we opened. And one of the reasons is, you know, we employ a lot of people, and they shop in the community, they eat in the community, and local businesses actually have tended to improve and flourish in the wake of our casino openings. We've had very good relationships with the chambers of commerce and local businesses in Des Plaines, in Philadelphia, and in Pittsburgh. Here's some representative quotations from the head of the Chamber of Commerce in Des Plaines, president and CEO of the Chamber of Commerce in Philadelphia, and also in Pittsburgh. And we have very, very good relationships with the local business communities, and we imagine that in Brockton it would be no different. In Des Plaines, we built the first LEED certified gold casino. Our casino in Brockton will also be LEED certified. The casino that we're building in Schenectady is also LEED certified. We're very proud of the kinds of casinos we design. We make sure that they are integrated into the local community. It's not going to be something that's inappropriate. It's not going to be a big glitzy Vegas casino that's going to be coming to Brockton. We've got some renderings to show you. We really take seriously local input and try to make sure that that what we build is accepted, appropriate, and good for the community. So that's a little bit of background on the casinos that we have so far. I want to take you now to what's going to be happening here, we hope, in Brockton. So the state is divided up into three regions, Region A, B, and C. We are in Region C. Here's a flyover of the casino site. You can see it highlights the fairground site. Here's more of a close-up view. Again, this is a current site plan. Things are always subject to change, but this is currently how we envision what the site plan is going to look like. You can see the surface parking. There's going to be a parking garage, and then towards the right-hand side where the food and beverage gaming is going to be. So I know there was a rendering, I think, released last week. This is one of those views. You can see in the center where the hotel is going to be. You can see with the facade of the building what we imagine that's going to look like. Here's another rendering. You can see the casino entrance there towards the, just a little bit right of center, the hotel on the left. So here are the basics so far for the site. It's a $650 million investment. The gaming, about 240,000 square foot gaming facility. We'll have a 25,000 square foot multi-purpose event entertainment space. We'll have a lot of restaurant, food and beverage offerings. We're going to have a hotel. will be a very nice hotel. We imagine having a spa, health club, a pool, and approximately 3,000 parking spaces. So this is not much more than just a casino. It's really a resort destination with a lot of options, entertainment, food and beverage, dining for the good people who decide they'd like a nice day out or night out. Oops. From an employment standpoint, we think about 1,500 permanent jobs will be at the resort, with average compensation. This is very similar to our other projects, of median compensation of $50,000 that includes benefits. Our benefit packages, we feel, a very good one. Medical, dental, vision, 401k that immediately vests, then we actually contribute to. Tuition reimbursement programs, if people want to get an education, they want to further their education, we will actually fully reimburse them up to $5,000 a year. Team members are eligible for service bonuses. If they're, we take very seriously giving great customer service. We have programs that we measure improvement in that service, and team members can get up to $1,000 per year for continuously improving service. We offer domestic partner benefits. And also, we believe about 1,400 construction jobs will be coming with this project. So in terms of identifying the right candidates and helping people understand how they can come get a job with us, May 2nd, we're hosting a workforce development forum. We'll be bringing in executives and other folks from our casinos around the country to help with that, convey that information and answer questions for people. We've done these in other locations, and they've been very well received. We plan on giving a hiring preference to local community and also training for pre-opening. In Pittsburgh, by the way, 80% of the people that we opened the project with had never had a job in gaming. So while certain jobs are going to require some gaming experience, the vast majority don't. And so you don't have to have worked in a casino before in order to be able to get a good job with us. For example, if somebody wants to be a dealer, we actually conduct our own dealer school, so people who have no background at all, we pay for the school, we pay for the training, they can come, and if that's what they want to do and they can pass the dealer school, that's one way to get what we feel is a very good career opportunity with us. We provide ongoing career development, tons of training, whether it's safety training, responsible gaming training, alcohol awareness training, lots and lots of different kinds of training. If people, again, want to learn how to do another job at the casino, we can provide training for that as well. We have education wellness programs in addition. We're very focused on promoting from within, and we've had, I think this slide's a little out of date, we're probably over 2,000 team members now that have been promoted since our casinos have opened, and in the last year, over 400 people have received a promotion. We think it's great when somebody can do a great job and be able to move up within the organization. And then for Brockton local businesses, we are going to be holding a vendor forum on May 1st, so that's the day before the Workforce Development Forum, to help educate local vendors on how to do business with the casino. You know, we're a highly regulated industry. There are a lot of licensing requirements, and we think it's very important for folks to know ahead of time, you know, these are the things that you're going to need to establish. There are going to be, I'm sure, different thresholds for licensing. If you if we're doing a large amount of business, there's a higher licensing requirement than if we're doing a small amount of business. But it's just really important that people understand what those requirements are, so they can do business with us. And again, it's been very successful everywhere that we've operated, and we take that upon our shoulders, because we want to make sure that we offer as many opportunities as possible for local businesses, because we do a significant amount of spend, and as much of that as possible we want to do in the local community. So we waited till almost the last for the really good news for Brockton. That's the financial benefits. You can see how those are outlined. This is in the host community agreement, but the biggest benefit, the biggest number, is the minimum annual payment equal to the greater of $10 million or 2.25% of gaming revenue. You can see how it's split out. Additionally, there are other taxes, hotel taxes, meal taxes, et cetera, that we think will generate another $1.5 to $2 million per year. We are going to be doing impact studies to assess impact on city traffic, utilities, public safety, and on the city generally, schools, housing, et cetera. It's very important to us that we provide a great experience for our customers and that we have a great relationship in every city that we operate in. So we take these studies very seriously. If there are traffic issues, and we know that there are going to be traffic enhancements that we will need to provide, there are a number of them that are already underway. We will help accelerate those, but then we'll also be contributing as well. Because it doesn't make sense for us to open a casino and have our customers, or anybody else for that matter, have problems with traffic. So we take that very seriously. And one of the good pieces about casino customers and traffic is that our customer flow is actually fairly steady throughout the day. And you don't really have like a big rush hour. We don't have people rushing to the casino at 8 in the morning when people are trying to get to work. And we don't have people rushing to the casino at 5 or 6 at night when people are trying to get away from work. So our traffic patterns actually should be complementary to the city as opposed to making it worse. But we know that there are some improvements, and we're committed to getting those done. So in sum, we think everybody wins. Brockton definitely wins with the project investment, the economic boost, the jobs, and revenue generation for the local community, and also, you know, can be a place that's it's put on the map in terms of drawing some regional tourism as well. So we're extremely excited about the opportunity to be here in Brockton. We've had great experience with everybody that we've met so far. We've appreciated the support the City Council has provided us so far, and the other people that we've met. We're just, you know, couldn't be more happy or more excited about the next, what we hope is a long relationship. Obviously, the referendum on May 12th is going to be critical, and we appreciate everybody's support. We'll be working very hard to make sure that we get a great turnout and a great result for that referendum. And with that, happy to take any questions. I've also, just so you know, and Scott and Ryan, if you could stand up. Scott Struzaner, who's also with Rush Street, has spent a lot of time here. Ryan Tennant as well, our Director of Finance. Neil couldn't come today. He'll be here tomorrow for the public forum. So Neil will be appearing with us tomorrow night.
Questions for any of the speakers? Yes.
Hi. Thanks so much. I know in the host city agreement, which was signed back in February, it says that immediately upon signing that agreement, the impact study has to commence. And that impact study will look at traffic issues, infrastructure issues, utility issues. Will we as voters have a chance to read that impact study before the 12th? Do you have any idea when that will be available?
That's a good question. Scott, do you want to?
Hello, my name is Scott Struzaner. Thanks for coming out. We really appreciate it.
Can't hear you.
A little closer to the mic there.
Hello, my name is Scott Struzaner. Thanks for coming out. We really appreciate it. To address your question, part of this entire process, somewhat parallel to what we're doing here in the city, is the MEPA process. And so while part of the traffic impact study that we're doing under the host community agreement won't be done in time, we are filing what they call an ENF filing, which is a preliminary filing under the MEPA process prior to May 12th, and that will have a traffic study associated with it. The impact study that we're doing for the city probably will be an even more elaborate traffic study, but that one will be publicly filed prior to May 12th. So the traffic study will be made available. The other ones probably, timing-wise, probably won't be ready in time for May 12th, but to the extent that traffic is probably one of the, you know, things that people are interested in, that one should be ready in time.
And just a quick follow-up. My understanding is that any mitigation agreement will not be negotiated until after the license is awarded, if it is, correct? So the information we'll get is just the impact, or will there be a discussion on mitigation?
So we intend, once the impact studies are completed, we intend to engage in the process of working out the mitigation agreement with the city. It would be my expectation that probably will take place actually before the license is awarded. At the Gaming Commission's last meeting, Right now, they said that the applications are due in July. The date hasn't been finally set, but that was the last discussion. And, you know, the selection will take place sometime after that. My guess is that we'll be working on a mitigation agreement but before that.
Any other questions for Rush? Come on, you gotta have questions, people. Come on, I know you do. I know you do. Yes, sir.
The landscape's been changing a little bit over the last couple of years. We've got Plain Ridge coming up in June. And then Wind Everett is gonna be opening possibly 2017. We've got the Wampanoag Indians trying to get something approved by the federal government in Taunton. And then you have Twin River in Lincoln, Rhode Island. That doesn't take into account what's going to happen in Springfield, Massachusetts, and then the two existing casinos in Connecticut. How do you view this in terms of the competitive landscape? What do you consider to be a geographic market area for the facility?
We've gone into this project knowing what the current landscape is and anticipating that there's going to be a casino where in the Boston area. We didn't know whether it was going to be Mohegan Sun or Wynn. The location of the two really didn't impact our numbers too much. We very well aware of the Penn project, the slots only parlor as well. So the project we believe is, even with the Tribal Casino open, is still a very viable project. Without the Tribal Casino, we think it's, you know, even more viable, obviously. The geographic pull for this casino, and for most casinos, frankly, is usually in the 30 to 60 minute drive time from the casino. Unless you're talking about, you know, the casinos in Las Vegas, which are clearly in a very different situation where you're pulling people, you know, really from all over the country. The Connecticut casinos, because they for a long time really were the only game in town, they drew from a much larger region. But if you look at now where people have convenience gaming in Pennsylvania, they have it in New York, they have it in Maryland, you know, the reach of those casinos has narrowed substantially. Twin River does very well. That's also impacted the Connecticut casinos. But we're, you know, we've done a number of different studies, and we generally take a very conservative view. We'll give a haircut to what the estimates are, just, you know, to make sure that we're being prudent, we're being conservative. You know, Neil doesn't want to put up you know, a whole bunch of his equity if he doesn't think that the project's going to be successful, and he's proven to be very, you know, astute with how he invests his money. So we think this is a very exciting project. We think it's going to be very, very successful. The Tribal Casino, while that's potentially out there, there are so many hurdles for that tribe to overcome that, you know, it's very hard to predict, but it's likely still years away. And frankly, the Wynn project, you know, based on some of the delays that they've had, I think their announcement last week was that they may be pushed into late 2018 before they'd be open. So, you know, if things go well for us here, we could be open well before the Wynn project even. But, you know, we've got to take things one step at a time. You know, I think tomorrow's going to be a really good opportunity for people because, you know, one, they get to ask questions like this to us, but also we're going to have Wendy Hamilton, who's our general manager of the Sugar House Casino in Philadelphia. It's a very similar situation because there's actually a neighborhood, the Fishtown neighborhood, is directly across a street from the casino. And before we opened the Sugar House, there was a lot of opposition in the local neighborhood. I remember before we even started construction, first time I was there, I took a walk back through the houses, and almost every house had a no casino sign. I mean, it was clear how those people felt about the casino. And if you, and we're also bringing with us tomorrow a gentleman who lives in Fishtown and is a neighborhood representative, and I think he can speak very eloquently on how that relationship has gone and how the good people of Fishtown feel about the casino now, because the kinds of negative impacts that they anticipated just didn't happen. You know, the casino itself, you may have noise and action inside the casino, but there's a significant buffer, number one. You know, you've got walls and you know, the parking lot is well lit, but there are not flashing lights or music blaring out from the casino that people can actually hear itself. So I think it'll be great to have some folks who actually are associated with that project, which is really the closest analogy, I think, to what we have here, and also how we've been received by the local neighborhood there as well. So we take the concerns very seriously, but I think the more people learn about it, the more actual facts they get from an actual history of what's happened before, the more comfort that they'll have with the project.
Yeah. Thanks, David. Just a few other things to elaborate on your question. Neil takes great pride in that his heritage is as a developer. And so he always reinforces with us a lot that what we do should be appropriate for the community, it should fit in, and should be responsible. We tried very early on to send, just as an example, a strong message that we take that responsibility very seriously. So for example, we voluntarily filed proposed zoning language. We voluntarily put in there certain things to send the message that we care about the community around us. So for example, you know, most people probably don't know that the site currently is zoned C2, which would allow, for example, retail development to take place by right. So someone could go in there, build a big shopping center, and the current setbacks are 20 feet. So someone could put the back of a shopping center with dumpsters, etc., within 20 feet of a residential district. We voluntarily put in 80 feet. And currently, most parts of our site plan that are adjacent to residential are even more than that. We show, you know, if you took a look at, you know, and tomorrow night we'll probably go over this more, you know, we have landscaping buffering, we have certain berms in certain areas. Most of, to your constituents who I believe are on the east side, you know, most of the entrances in the action are on the west side. You know, people are coming from Route 24, and they'll either, you know, if you picture what the site plan is, the main parking lots are to the west of the casino and to the south a bit. So most of the action will be away from your constituents. There is some parking on our site plan for the employees, but it's not where the customers are coming in. We also try to be very sensitive, for example, on height. So, you know, we said that our hotel, we designed a hotel that was 7 stories plus the height of slope roofs, you know, to be appropriate for kind of the visual aesthetics in that area. When we chose the architecture, the roof lines, the masonry facades, just the look and feel of the whole development, we worked really hard so that when people saw it, we said, you know, we were really hoping that their first impression would be, wow, you know what? We can really envision that being in our community. They've taken into account, you know, concerns of not just the community, but people who live immediately around the site. And so we've really tried to address those things.
Thank you. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Yes, you mentioned recreation and entertainment section in the hotel.
Yes. Well, we'll certainly have plans to bring in entertainment. It's very early to be able to say what, you know, what that level of entertainment is, or, you know, what that looks like. How we book in Pittsburgh, for example, which has you know, some dedicated, and you know, I think we have about 10,000 square feet of entertainment space in Pittsburgh. We do bring some nice acts in. It's not, you know, big arena acts or anything like that, but it's also got to be appropriate for the casino customer. So, you know, acts that are popular with, you know, the usually, you know, 40 to 65 crowd, But you know, we also it's a very diverse mix. It's diverse in terms of demographics. It's diverse in terms of types of music. But you know, it's generally people that could draw anywhere from 500 to maybe 1,500, sometimes 2,000 people. We've also done sporting events as well. We've done boxing in Pittsburgh. That's been successful. There's a lot of different things that are potentially on the table. I have to defer to him on who's. Go ahead.
Will the permanent jobs include any union workers?
All of the construction jobs are going to be with the trades, which are union. In terms of the permanent jobs, it's really too early to say. We have always favored the choice of our team members as to whether they want to join a union or not. We do have a number of team members at our property in Pittsburgh that just actually voted to join a union. One of our groups there did, and in Philadelphia we have two groups that are union. The rest have chosen to be non-union. And at this time, we want our team members to choose what they want, and we've always favored that. So we'll see how that plays out.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, there actually is some in Philadelphia, which is really it's the one location that is in a residential area. The casino in Des Plaines is mainly in a more of a commercial. I mean, there's residential that's fairly close, but there are no, you know, houses right across the street. And Pittsburgh, just so people know, we're on the north shore of Pittsburgh, so it's north of downtown. We're in a district that's got, we're right next to Heinz Field, where the that football team, I always forget their name. All I know is the Patriots, where that football team plays. And then we're also down the street from where the Pirates play. And we're actually right next to the Carnegie Mellon. It's a science center for families and kids. They're actually the closest to us. So Philadelphia, Fishtown, rents in Fishtown are actually up 41% since we opened. And that's, I think, the fifth highest gain in the city of Philadelphia. So from a property value standpoint, you know, if that's, you know, that data point would tell you that it hasn't had at all a negative impact at all.
That's on the commercial side, right?
those are people living in apartments. No, there are. I'm the only, you asked for like, are there studies, is there actual data? The one data point that we actually have is if you look at how the apartment, how rentals are, whether it's home rentals or apartment rentals, but it's residential, those rents have actually increased substantially since we opened the casino. It has not had a negative impact. And I think if you ask, you know, if you ask people who are, you know, either live close or do business, and there was actually an article in the Worcester paper a couple years ago when Worcester was considering whether they were going to have gaming. And they looked at Twin River and they looked at Pittsburgh. And the article talked about, and they interviewed people who own businesses, the positive impact that the casinos had had in their neighborhoods from a business standpoint, in terms of bringing customers to the area, employees of the casinos, you know, eating out and patronizing the shops and restaurants and stores. And it was a very positive view of what the casinos had done in those areas. And I mean, I can tell you, I think the quotes from the folks at the Chamber of Commerce in the cities that we do business, the impacts are far better than what some of the critics will say. And again, we try to be very fact-based and talk about, well, what's actually happened with our casinos in the towns that we operate? What's our relationship with our team members? What's our relationship with the cities? What's our relationship with the business community and the local communities around? And it's very, very positive.
Well, there's the facts, there's the figures, the people, your old Brocktonians, telling you how they felt about it. You're our mouthpiece out there. I do understand that you, my brothers and sisters in business, don't all live here within the city, but you are the mouthpiece of your neighborhoods. This is very important for all of us. So when you come to Brockton as a destiny and as people with disposable income, keep in mind $650 million investment in the city of Brockton, 1,500 jobs paying $50,000 with full benefit packages, gift cards for the businesses in the downtown and suburban areas. This is what they're all about. You had a chance to hear everybody, see it. Tomorrow night there'll be another forum at the West Middle School at 7 o'clock, and that's for mostly the residents. But you, as residents, should attend to be there to be fully informed. So when Brockton is home, everything is in the reach. My name is Gary Leonard. It's been a pleasure being your host this evening, and thank you all for taking your time to come out and hear. Thank you.